everybody, and welcome to the Reboot Rose live stream here on October 16th. We're in the spooky season here this year, so we're going to cover a little bit of our literary series, starting off with a spooky novel, one of my personal favorites, The Cask of the Amontillado. This was written by Edgar Allan Poe, and it tells the tale of a man who believes he was done wrong. We're going to do a small excerpt of the beginning of the story. The thousands injuries of Fortunato I had borne as I best could, but when he ventured upon insult, I vowed revenge. You, who are so well known the nature of my soul, will not suppose, however, that gave utterance to a threat. At length I would be avenged. This was the point definitely settled, but the very definitiveness with which it was resolved precluded the idea of risk. I must not only punish, but punish with impunity, a wrong so unredressed. When retribution overtakes its redresser, it is equally unredressed when the avenger fails to make himself felt as such to him who has done the wrong. It must be understood that neither by word nor deed had I given Fortunato cause to doubt my goodwill. I continued, as was worth my wont, to smile on his face, and indeed he did not perceive that my smile now was a thought of immolation. He had a weak point, this Fortunato, although in other regards he was a man to be respected, and even feared. He prided himself on his connoisseurship of wine. Few Italians had a true virtuoso spirit. For the most part, their enthusiasm was adopted to suit the time and opportunity to practice imposture upon the British and Austrian millionaires. In painting of gemmery, Fortunato, like his countrymen, was a quack. In a matter of old wines, he was sincere. In his respect, I did not differ from his materially. I was skiffle in the Italian villages myself, and brought largely wherever I could. It was about dusk one evening, during the supreme madness of the carnival season, but I encountered my friend. He accosted me with an excessive warmth, but he had been drinking much. The man wore motley. He was in tight-fitting Paris-striped dress, and his head was surmounted with a conical cap and bells. I was so pleased to see him that I thought I should have not done wringing his hand. I said to him, "My dear Fortunato, you are lucky met. How remarkably well you are looking today. But I have received a pipe of what passes for Amontillado, and I have my doubts." "How?" he said. "Amontillado? A pipe? Impossible. In the middle of Carnival?" "I have my doubts," I replied, "and I was silly enough to pay full Amontillado price without consulting you on the matter. You were not to be found, and I was fearful of losing a bargain." "Amontillado? I have my doubts." "Amontillado? And I must satisfy them." "Amontillado? As you are engaged, I am on my way to Lucrece. For if anyone has a critical turn as he will tell me..." "Lucrece cannot tell Amontillado from Sherry. And yet some fools will have it with his tastes as match of yours. Come, let us go." "Whither?" "To your vaults." "My friend, no. I will not impose upon your good nature to perceive you have the engagement." "Lucrece, I have no engagement. Come." "My friend, no. It is not the engagement, but the severe cold of which I perceive you are afflicted. The vaults are insufferably damp, and they are encrusted in nitre. Let us, nevertheless, the cold is merely nothing." "Amontillado, I have been imposed upon, and as for Lucrece, he cannot distinguish Sherry from Amontillado." Thus speaking, Fortunato possessed himself of my arm, and putting it in the mask of black silks, and drawing a roquelicon close upon my person, I suffered him to hurry to my palazzo. There were no attendants at home, and they had absconded to make merry in the honor of time. I had told them that I should not return until the morning, and had given them explicit orders not to stir from the house. These orders were sufficient, I well knew, to ensure their immediate disappearance, one and all, as soon as my back was turned. I took upon the Lascances two flambeaux, and gave them to one to Fortunato, bowed him through several suites of rooms to an archway that led into the vaults. I passed down a long, winding staircase, requesting him to be cautious as he followed. We came to a length of the foot of the descent, and stood together upon the damp ground of the catacombs of the Montessors. That was an excerpt from A Cask of the Amontillado by Edgar Allan Poe. Now, you might be wondering why we selected The Cask of the Amontillado as our first literary series. Now, the obvious answer would be that it's Halloween. And so we wanted to talk a little bit about what was going on with the spookier side of our stories. The second part is that The Cask of Amontillado was originally written in 1846, right around the time that our city was founded. It's one of the most popular stories that was written by Edgar Allan Poe to go along with The Raven and A Telltale Heart. Now, what was special about this, along with a few of other of his writings, was that it was originally produced in a series of books called the Goody's Lady Books. Now, the Goody's Lady Books was a women's magazine that was produced from 1830 to 1878, and it was highly circulated. In fact, the most widely circulated magazine pre-Civil War. So many of the women who would have been coming across on wagons would have been waiting for their copy of this magazine. In fact, in 1860, the magazine had 150,000 readers, up from about 70,000 in the 1840s. So 70,000 people were reading his story, The Cask of the Amontillado. Now, like I said, these books would have come across on the wagon trains, and women would have had them shipped out on the Pony Express out to California and out to the Oregon region. So we wanted to share one of his stories to kind of discuss how that would happen. Now, finally, we did want to discuss what's going on right now at the Row. Currently at the Row, we are open for our fall hours, 1 to 4 p.m., and we do hope that you're willing to come by and see us and check out what we've got going. And we did just recently put in a celluloid exhibit like we talked about last week. It's really awesome. Come check it out. And we do have some amazing pieces from both Cat Designs and Moonlight Leather. I know some of you have probably been watching KQ2. We do have a new showcase up on KQ2 that we will share on here at some point. We definitely would love you guys to check that out as well. And we do hope you guys do come back next week. We'll see what we may be doing another podcast next week. And if there's any other authors you guys are definitely interested in hearing about, definitely do let us know down in the comments section below. And we do look forward to hearing from you all. And thanks so much for joining us here on the Reboot Heroes live stream.